Good afternoon. My name is Dennis Cross. I am Vice President of the World War I Historical Association and a volunteer at the National World War I Museum. And I want to join Dr. Naylor and the others in welcoming you to this symposium. It's my pleasure this afternoon to introduce our next speaker, Professor Martha Hanna. Martha is professor of history at the University of Colorado in Boulder. She received her PhD from Georgetown University in 1989 and is a specialist in the cultural and social history of the Great War. She is the author of The Mobilization of Intellect, French Scholars and Writers During the Great War. And most recently, Your Death Would Be Mine, Paul and Marie Perrault in the Great War, published by Harvard University Press in 2006, which won the J. Russell Major Prize from the American Historical Association, the Colorado Book Award, and the Distinguished Book Award from the Society for Military History. A contributor to several international collaborative projects to mark the centenary of the outbreak of World War I, Professor Hanna is currently working on a book-length study of the impact of war on marriage in France, Britain, and Canada during and immediately after World War I. Professor Hanna will speak on the subject, War of Words, Words of War. Please join me in welcoming Professor Hanna.
Thank you very much. I would like to echo the comments that have been made already, and those are of appreciation and thanks to the staff of the museum, and most particularly to George Thompson for extraordinary efforts in making this symposium come about. He has been a model of organizational efficiency and kindness. So it's worked together. It's not just, please do it. It's, please do it. So it's been a real pleasure to be part of this enterprise. This is working, right? Yeah, okay. The question was very vexed, certainly during the war. And that is the relationship between culture and the war. And I would like us to start by thinking about a publication that is perhaps one of those events that has been almost forgotten. You might want to think of it as one of the most important documents generated by the war that nobody's ever heard of. And that document is, we don't need all this words stuff, a document produced in October of 1914 by 93 German prominent scholars. The formal title of the publication was The Appeal to the Civilized World. But because of the prominence of the signatories, this document became known far and wide as the Manifesto of 93. And this Manifesto of 93 would shape the cultural conversation in Germany and in the Entente powers for the rest of the war. It was extraordinarily controversial for reasons that I think will become obvious in just a second. The Manifesto of 93 made three key points. First, it denied that the German army in August and September of 1914 had committed atrocities in their campaign into Belgium and northern France. It acknowledged that some interventions against civilian society had been made, but it justified them on the grounds of military necessity. Secondly, the Manifesto of 93 acclaimed the distinctiveness of German culture. And the third, and perhaps the most controversial element of the manifesto, was the argument that the distinctiveness of German culture that was widely recognized and applauded throughout Europe a culture that was renowned for its musical genius in Beethoven, its literary genius in Goethe, its philosophical genius in Kant, that this tradition of German cultural distinctiveness needed to be defended with military power. And the argument that the 93 signatories put forward was that the Entente scholars in Britain and in France recognized the genius of Germany, but claimed that that was separate from, in fact, antithetical to the militarist tradition of Germany. And what these 93 signatories assert is that because German culture was distinctive, because it was surrounded by cultural traditions that, in their judgment, were inferior, German culture needed to be defended through the might of arms, and that therefore the cultural tradition and the military tradition of Germany walked hand in hand. This document, as you might well imagine, provoked extraordinary conversation, we might say, throughout Western Europe and in the United States. Interestingly, the document was written as an appeal to neutral powers to try and bring the neutral forces onto the German side in this very heated conversation about whether the German army had committed atrocities. So it was a document that was targeted as much to Americans as it was to other Germans or to the Entente forces themselves. Perhaps one of the things that made this document so controversial, and also, I think, as importantly, so unexpected, was the prominence of the men who signed it. And I'm pretty sure they were all men. Many of them were people who had been acclaimed internationally as scholars, writers, scientists. Many had received recently the Nobel Prize, including Gerhard Hauptmann in 1912, or would receive the Nobel Prize, including Max Planck, at the end of the war. So these scholars were not nobodies. They were the crème de la crème, or however you say that in German, of German intellectual life. Beyond that, and this is what is going to prove to be so disorienting to the people who read the appeal to the civilized world, most of these signatories had been deeply embedded in an intellectual community that transcended and crossed national boundaries. It's customary, fashionable now to speak about transnational history. Well, these were men who were embedded in traditions of intellectual and exchange, scientific communication, congresses, and so forth. And so they had been part of a European intellectual tradition that now they seemed to be separating themselves from. The questions that arose as a result of the publication of the appeal to the civilized world was really a deep and complex question. And that is, what is or is there a relationship between war and culture? And although the manifesto itself did not make this question explicit, the question that I want us to think about for the next 20 minutes or half hour is, was there something in European culture prior to 1914 that predisposed Europeans to think that war was either something to be welcomed, something that was inevitable and that one had to resign oneself to, something that should be enthusiastically embraced? Or was there, in fact, a reticence, even a repugnance, to think about and to contemplate the possibility of war. Now, as the introduction made clear, I received my PhD a long time ago. And when I was going through college and graduate school, it was customary to make the following argument. And that was that by the early 20th century, that period of the fantasy, that emerged particularly in cultural circles among writers and poets, musicians and artists, there had emerged a weariness with the modern world and a sense that the modern world had become decadent, soft, materialistic, and just too darn comfortable. So there was a sense, the story goes, that among the young, the vanguard, the intellectually curious, there was a thirst for an invigorating experience that would liberate themselves from the banal, the blah, the everyday. Life was just too comfortable. What we really need is a good war. And there is certainly evidence in the cultural tradition, which I will talk about in just a second, of this kind of, not war weariness, but peace weariness. This sense that somehow life needed to be reinvigorated with some kind of deep existential challenge. And the individuals who are most identified with this belief that Europe had become too soft, too comfortable, and needed to be invigorated by war are the futurists, this young group of kind of crazy French students in Paris, and an equally idiosyncratic artistic movement in Britain in 1914. Perhaps the most famous proponent, exponent of the idea that war would be a reviving, a revitalizing, a regenerating experience was the founder of the Italian modernist movement, the futurist, Filippo Marinetti. And Marinetti argued in his Futurist Manifesto, published in 1909, that Europe needed to move beyond the comfortable, the ordinary, and it needed to embrace a new, a vigorous, and an unapologetically bellicose mentality. This is what the Futurist Manifesto of 1909 said, part of it at least. We want to sing the love of danger, the habit of energy and rashness. Beauty exists only in struggle. We want to glorify war, the only cure for the world. Militarism, patriotism, the destructive gesture of the anarchists, the beautiful ideas which kill, and this is the best part, and contempt for women. A year later, Marinetti reaffirmed these futurist principles and spoke of his apostles as a group of absolutely rebellious and destructive young people who are tired of adoring the past, sick of academic pedantry, avid for reckless originality, yearning for an adventurous, energetic, heroic life. It's interesting that Marinetti would focus some of his bile and his contempt on university professors. It's something we will see recurring among the other young men of the pre-war years, or at least the very small social elite. Because one of the things that I think we need to keep in mind is how unrepresentative these ideas really are. They are the ideas of the proudly and exclusively avant-garde. They are not attempting to speak for the masses. In fact, they would deign to say that the masses don't deserve to be spoken for at all. This is particularly evident, oh, we'll go back one, in a group, unfortunately I couldn't find any photographs of this particular group, but in 1912, perhaps in response to the survey that Mike Nyberg quoted earlier that was conducted by the Mercure de France, in 1912, a group of ardently right-wing nationalist French writers and scholars conducted a very unscientific poll of the people whom they thought were likely to be the intellectual leaders of the future of France. So they went to the various faculties at the University of Paris. They identified students who the other students kept speaking of as, oh, you have to talk to so-and-so. So they didn't conduct anything like a scientific poll. But what they did was engage in conversations with a group of young, ardent French university students. And what these university students, the young people of today, said was very much like what Marinetti had said. They were disgusted with the older generation. Is there anything new in that? They were convinced that their father's generation were too complacent, too willing to play nice, too willing to forget the national dishonor of losing Alsace and Lorraine. And what these young men, as I say, very selectively polled in 1912, said was that France needed war. It needed war to reinvigorate itself. It needed war to restore national honor. It needed war to reclaim the lost provinces. And what they said was lacking in France, particularly of their parents' generation, was a spirit of heroism. These young men were, quote, exalted by a patriotic faith and the cult of bellicose virtues. They were waiting for an opportunity to become heroic. A very similar sense of boredom, disdain for the status quo, disgust at the complacency of the older generation is also evident in this modernist poetic and artistic movement that emerges in Britain on the very eve of war. The first issue of the Vorticist movement was published as a manifesto in July of 1914. And like the Futurists, the Vorticists acclaimed the power of modern machinery. They exulted in the speed and the destructiveness of it all. And more than anything else, they thumbed their noses at what they took to be the staid and polite traditions of contemporary Britain. All of these individuals are cited as evidence of a thirst in Europe for war and of an eagerness, particularly among the young, to break free of the stultifying bonds of their everyday life and to find something heroic in the in a future that they believed would be valorized and vindicated by war. But what I want to suggest partly is that these are not speaking for most Europeans. These are a very privileged elite group who, quite frankly, have the leisure to indulge in, I think, quite silly ideas. Other scholars have looked to the pre-war era and have said, well, if Europeans weren't actively embracing the idea of war as a valorous and liberating experience, they were at least thinking about the inevitability of war. They were thinking that somehow the circumstances in which Europe found itself would lead necessarily to war. And that this conviction in the inevitability of war was most clearly articulated, especially in Britain, but not exclusively in Britain, in a whole spate of novels about invasion. Britain was going to be invaded by one force or another. Germany also talked about it. And so there was kind of a potboiler tradition that emerges from the 1890s right through to before the war, in which the recurring theme and leitmotif is that whatever country you live in is going to be subjected to invasion, and we need to sort of stand up and protect ourselves. Perhaps the most famous exemplar of this invasion literature movement is William Le Queux, who published a gazillion books, the most famous one of which came out in 1906, The Invasion of 1910. And it was published quite explicitly to try and encourage the British to think about how to prepare themselves militarily for war, and especially to encourage the idea that Britain needed conscription. Well, that idea didn't sell, but the book certainly sold in large quantities. One of the features that I find most interesting about much of this invasion literature is a recurrent motif, especially from the point of view of Britain. And that is that Britain was vulnerable to overseas invasion through the strangest thing you could possibly imagine: a tunnel built under the English Channel that would allow, in this case, French soldiers to invade Britain and to dishonor it. Now, this notion of the tunnel goes back, at least as far as I can tell, to the Napoleonic era. So it's kind of a recurring sort of national nightmare. And in fact, even when the British were building the tunnel, I don't think they were as worried about invasions by Frenchmen, but they were very worried about invasions by bats, because they feared that it would bring rabies into the UK. So this notion that somehow Britain was vulnerable to attack through a tunnel was one that came up. And interestingly, you didn't have to be attacked by the Germans. In fact, you might well ask the question how the Germans would even get to the tunnel to get over to Britain. So it was as common to think of the tunnel being used as an attack by the French as it was by the British. So those are sort of examples of how European writers, highbrow, middlebrow, lowbrow, used either the idea that war was a liberating experience, or the idea that war was an inevitable experience, to take issue with the circumstances of the day. And I think that's interesting. Doesn't that suggest, perhaps, that what they're fighting against is a sense that war isn't going to happen, that this is something that you have to cultivate, you have to invent in order to awaken people from their late 19th, early 20th century complacency. Another idea that I'd like to just throw out there is how much credence do we actually need to give to recurring themes in popular literature? I mean, as far as I can tell, the most recurring theme in modern American popular literature and film are zombies. Right? What does that mean? Does it mean, you know, if 20 years from now we're going to be invaded by zombies, are we then going to go back and say, see, it was all in the culture, we all knew it was going to happen all along? Or is it just, it's kind of a crazy idea. It's entertaining. Perhaps it's entertaining precisely because we know we're not going to be invaded by zombies. So I think we need to think about these sort of recurring motifs and ask precisely how much they expressed genuine anxieties about the possibility of war, let alone genuine excitement about the possibility of war. Because one of the things that I discovered very recently in relation to the Channel was that in 1912, a very long essay was published in the New York Times talking about the engineering possibility of building a tunnel underneath the English Channel. And this was not being presented as a nightmare scenario. This was being presented as an initiative that the British and the French could undertake together to mark 100 years of peace. And the expectation was that if they started digging pretty soon, this is 1912, the tunnel underneath the channel would be open in time to recognize the 100th anniversary of the Battle of Waterloo. This symbol of a century of peace would, according to this writer in the New York Times, be ready to be open in June of 1915. And what that suggests, I think, is that the Europeans were as interested in the possibility of thinking about continuing the century of peace as they were in thinking about its imminent decline. And in particular, we see this confidence in a peaceful future emerge in two different ways. One is perhaps quite predictable, and that is the growth of the European peace movement from the late 1880s through to, quite literally, the day before the war started. Now, you'll notice that I suspect that in the course of this entire symposium, we're not going to see many women. Well, here we have one. Bertha von Suttner, what emerged at the end of the 19th century through her literary writing, her very popular novels, as one of the most distinguished proponents of peace. And her argument was that war was a moral abomination, and in particular, it would bring sort of social and emotional devastation, not just to the men who fought it, but also to their families. In the aftermath of the Dreyfus Affair, picking up on a point that Mike made this morning, France became not more interested in the allure of militarism, our young men of today notwithstanding, but in fact more skeptical about the power of military might. And one of the most prominent French individuals to emerge in the aftermath of the Dreyfus Affair as a spokesman for international cooperation, intellectual cooperation, and international peace is Victor Bach. And I don't know if his name rings any bells with you, but he was a very, very distinguished scholar and Dreyfusard who regrettably came to a very, very sad end in the Second World War when he was assassinated by the Gestapo. What Victor Bach, Bertha von Suttner, and others argued is that there emerges in the early 20th century a very different, a very anti-bellicose sentiment. And that is a sentiment of internationalism and of cosmopolitanism. So if we go back once again to Mike's four claims, you know, the main arguments, nationalism by all means existed, but it was offset by a very strong cultural predilection for cosmopolitanism, for working across national boundaries. And this was especially evident among university scholars. Perhaps one of the reasons that some of their students were so disdainful of them was that the old men of today, the university professors from 1900 to 1914, were so actively engaged in Britain, in France, in Germany, in creating opportunities for international exchanges, for student exchanges, for working collaboratively, for creating intellectual congresses and communities and academic associations. And we see this in a couple of different ways. One was to encourage students, perhaps especially the students who were enticed by the idea of the liberating power of war, to encourage students to become more familiar with people like them on the other side of the Rhine. Charles Andler was a very distinguished, prominent scholar. He was a Dreyfusard. He was also one of France's most highly regarded Germanists. He published widely in German literature and in German philosophy. And at the behest of the person who is basically the equivalent of the Ministry of Education in France, Charles Andler was asked to coordinate an exchange journey of university students from Paris to go to Germany and to meet students, to meet professors, and to recognize through this exchange how much these scholars and students were like themselves. And the justification for Charles Andler's program to take students from France to Germany was, I quote, to allow students the opportunity to realize a constant, reasoned, methodical initiation into the intellectual, artistic, and economic life of our great neighbor. So rather than encouraging them to think of Germany as this demonic other that had stripped France of Alsace-Lorraine and which could never be forgiven, there was, in the period after the first Moroccan crisis, a strong impulse in France, in Germany, in Britain, to encourage the fruitful interchange between French, German, British students. German students, under the auspices of the Rhodes Scholarship, went to study at Oxford. And so there is, at the level of students, a strong impulse to try and acquire familiarity with a foreign culture. So we might want to think of this as sort of the earliest stages of a study abroad program. But beyond that, we also see this instinct or this initiative to encourage international and intellectual exchange at the ranks of some of the most distinguished published scholars of their day. And I want to conclude by just mentioning one, I think, very interesting little episode. Émile Boutroux, another Frenchman, was a very, very prominent, internationally acclaimed scholar. In the spring of 1914, he went on an international tour that took him to the United States, took him to Great Britain, and then in May of 1914, took him to Berlin. He met with scholars at the University of Berlin. He addressed an audience, probably as large or larger than this. And the topic that Émile Boutroux addressed to wide acclaim in this university audience at the University of Berlin was French and German thought, the mutual advantages each can offer the other. And not only did Boutroux make that claim, that it was right, this was the right moment for French and German scholars to continue to work together and to collaborate. But his host, graciously, spoke of Boutroux's visit to the University of Berlin as an important date in the international relations of France and Germany. And I close with that anecdote from May of 1914, because I think it helps us understand two things. First, it helps us understand the astonishment with which men like Boutroux and Andler and others greeted the Manifesto of 93. These were people whom only 3 months earlier had been willingly and enthusiastically engaged in intellectual and cultural exchanges with these German scholars. These German signatories were people respected, rewarded, honored in France and in Britain. And so with the publication of the Manifesto of 93, the intellectual community did not say, we saw this coming. This has been building up for years. It was rather, how could they? How could people we have been close intellectual friends with for years, how could they have abandoned that vision of intellectual cooperation? The second and final point that I want to conclude with is that many of us who have spent a lot of time thinking about sort of the cultural production of the First World War have been struck by how frequently people speak about the young men who went to war feeling that they had been betrayed by the old men. The old men are the people comfortably at home who can willingly send their kids to war, knowing that the war is not going to come into their own living room. So there's a lot of that kind of anger articulated towards the old men. But what I think we see in this story is that it's not the old men who wanted to send their sons to war. They wanted them to be safe. They wanted them to live in a world of peace. To the extent that anybody wanted to go to war in 1914, it wasn't the old men sending the young men. It was those poor, young, foolhardy, and not very many members of the intellectual avant-garde. Thank you.
We will take questions.
Yes.
We'll start with this gentleman.
Okay, the Manifesto of 93 was published and caused a lot of turmoil during the period of the war. What's the rest of the story? How did they come back together in the 20s, or did they?
They come back together very reluctantly. There have been works that have shown that this spirit of cosmopolitanism was quite active leading up to World War I, and that we can see this in the way in which people voted for who should receive the Nobel Prizes, particularly in medicine and in the sciences. And that there you really do see sort of a mutual respect across national lines. That disintegrates in the 20s. And so there is a much greater sense of mistrust, I think, after the war, partly because of the very vitriolic character of the debate in Germany, but also in Britain and France, that does tend to emphasize the distinctiveness and the difference between British culture and French culture on one side and German culture on the other. So there isn't a happy resolution that comes out at the end. The people who tend to come out of this with their international reputations unscathed are people like Einstein, who had pointedly chosen not to sign the signature, or not to be a signatory.
First, did the intellectual manifesto of the Germans and pre-war ferment to refer back to the devastations of the Napoleonic invasions or the 30 Years' War, remembering
no.
that?
No, it seems to be very, I mean, this would be sort of what we might expect of a bunch of intellectuals. It's very much grounded in what they take to be the brilliance of the German yeah. cultural tradition. Yeah. So it's not rooted in the social experiences.
And you haven't used the term socialism or Marxist thought or social Darwinism.
True.
Weren't they around?
They were indeed. And the Marxist tradition, of course, is interesting because on the one hand it does presuppose the inevitability of some kind of violent conflict, but it doesn't argue that this war that is about to happen works in the interests of the working classes. So the European socialist movement is one of the most, it's not entirely unanimous in its embrace of pacifism, but it's certainly one of the most it's one of the organizations that articulates the anti-war argument most frequently. The social Darwinists do speak, and to a certain extent, you know, those younger guys are picking up on that notion that somehow war is going to be the process by which the weak and the unfit will be eliminated and that you will emerge for. But I don't think it's quite as evident in the years right up to the war. It's more evident in the 1890s.
Along those lines, it seems that the intellectuals' interest in internationalism, which promotes their interest in peace, is very similar to the socialists' interest in international and workers uniting
yes.
Across lines. But it doesn't make sense to have the workers and the intellectual. I mean, they weren't part of the same classes.
True.
And certainly in the United States, we see this sort of combination also.
Yes.
How can you tell the differences between them? Because we see so many socialists in the United States who were pushing for peace.
Mm-hmm.
Where does it break down between these two movements, basically?
Well, I mean, I think what you're getting at is really, really important, and that is that there are probably three parallel cultural movements, all of which agree that peace is better than war. But they do so for different reasons. So the organization that speak of themselves first and foremost as peace movements, which are different than these intellectual cosmopolitans. They are very middle class. There's a very strong presence from the European feminist movement. And they are then regarded with a degree of skepticism by the European socialist movement. And in fact, the peace movement, the middle class feminist peace movement, is always somewhat wary of reaching out to the European socialist movement because they are afraid that that will discredit the peace movement itself, so that they will be spoken of as sort of the pawns of European socialism. So they exist in parallel, but they don't intersect. Very much. At the same time, the European socialists are equally suspicious of war. They think of it as a capitalist enterprise and as a capitalist plot, but they at the same time don't necessarily want to make overtures to the middle class feminist peace movement because they don't want to be identified with collaborating with the middle classes. So they're working to the same end, but to a certain degree at cross purposes, because they don't believe that they can work effectively together. Or they, in each case, they believe that their natural constituencies will look at them suspectly if they engage in some kind of collaboration. Does that answer?
Yeah. Your next question comes from the middle.
Yes.
Thank you. If I were a foreign intellectual, I would see the hand of the Wilhelmstrasse behind this manifesto. Is there any evidence that the foreign government, the German government, pushed these guys to get together and issue this manifesto?
No. It was initiated by one intellectual, but I haven't seen any references to it being generated by anybody else. I mean, I think there, you know, those of you who know John Horne and Alan Kramer's book about the German atrocities will know how deeply embedded in German sort of cultural sentiment in 1914, this idea of the untrustworthiness of the Belgians. So if you read sort of item by item through this manifesto, what they are saying is almost identical to what emerges from the diaries that John Horne and Alan Kramer looked at from frontline soldiers, that the Belgians are automatically untrustworthy, that German soldiers act with honor and commit offenses, they won't even call them offenses, but commit acts against civilians only because they are in a situation of literally of life and death, self-defense. And so what is being expressed in the manifesto is something that is quite widespread in the way German society understood what had happened in August and September of 1914.
I have a question then. If you could poll the millions of people who left Europe between 1890 and 1914,
yes.
Do you think that they would have, and you could have said, did you have a sense of coming and lasting peace, or did you have a sense of coming and impending war, given just what you said about your presentation and the various intellectual movements that were going on?
I don't know, to the extent that I know what those people would have said, I think they would have said that what was pushing them out of Europe, to some extent it was dislike with compulsory military service, but that didn't necessarily mean war, it just meant they didn't want to be conscripted. But more, I think, than anything else, it was economic opportunity. So I don't think, but there may well be people who know this much better than I. I don't think that they were fleeing what they took to be the imminent possibility of war.
Your next question is from the front corner.
To what extent were there parallels to all this cultural activity in Europe going on in the United States? I mean, there were peace movements, there were cultural exchanges, there was invasion literature as well. And what are the implications of that?
Oh. First part. I don't know. certainly, I mean, I think when I think about the American progressive movement and the sense that we have, you know, we can have the options of investing in social reform initiatives or investing in overseas expansion and imperialism, you certainly see parallels, but I don't know enough about the American situation before 1914 to say anything. Does anybody want to add to that? Because I'd be happy to hear it.
Well, there were certainly two kinds of progressives. There was the Theodore Roosevelt progressive, and he was very much in favor of overseas expansion.
Yeah, so. Yeah.
Next question.
Just a follow-up question on what you were just addressing. You said that the manifesto of 93 was largely an appeal to neutral powers, specifically the United States. What impact did it have in the United States, if any at all?
It had exactly the opposite impact than as had been intended. Because it seemed so... two things about it made it resonate in a very, very negative way. One was the disconnect between the intellectual reputation of the signatories who had made their worldwide reputation as voices of disinterested rational analysis. And so to the extent, especially for the scientists, that to the extent that they were esteemed, it was because their scholarship seemed to be above national interests. So there was a sense that, in effect, these guys had sold out. But secondly, because the arguments, and particularly the arguments about the German army, in effect, being innocent of the charges that were being made against it, because that argument was then juxtaposed with the very vociferous allied arguments about atrocities, many of which were exaggerated, it reinforced the notion that these German scholars were not speaking with a voice of reason. And so all over, I mean, every ally, every neutral power that I have read references, their intellectual community came together and published some kind of rebuttal to the Manifesto of 93 in the US, in Portugal, in Spain.
And the German-American community in the United States, did they embrace it more than others?
Don't know. Yeah.
Your next question is from the back.
To what extent can you say that the socialists, broadly speaking, were against what they perceived to be the wars between nations because they thought the real war should be a class war across national boundaries?
Yeah, and in fact, they argued that the best way to prevent a war would be for the workers recognizing their class identity and class interests just to refuse to fight. And that was, they continue to think that was a possibility through the summer of 1914.
I think we have time for one more question. Taylor, you might have to hustle.
Manifesto of 93, did they buy into the white supremacy that was rampant at the time?
It wasn't expressed.
A short answer to the
yes.
question. Okay. Fantastic. Since it was such a short answer, was there one more question? Wonderful. I think they see one down on this end.
Did any of the signatories to the Manifesto of 93, or for that matter, did Marinetti and the Futurists ever subsequently express regret for the
Max
views they
Planck.
Advanced?
Yeah, Max Planck did. And in fact, there's some debate as to whether or not he had read the text of the manifesto when he signed it. And shortly thereafter, I think he felt extremely remorseful and took steps to one of the consequences of the manifesto was to harden what you might think of as the intellectual battle lines. And one of the questions was, in Britain and in France, should the French various academies, like the Académie Française and Belles Lettres and so forth, should they remove from their list of honorary members any German scholar who had signed the manifesto? And this was a very, very heated debate. But at the same time, there was a parallel debate in Germany after the manifesto was issued, and Max Planck was one of the people who stood up and said that he did not think it would be appropriate for, say, the Berlin Academy to strip French scholars of their honorary membership. And it might well be that that distancing himself from identification with the manifesto could have contributed. I mean, obviously, many things contributed to him winning the Nobel Prize, but it could have contributed to a greater willingness on the part of Entente physicists to support his nomination. That and the fact that he was a genius.
Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.